It is with great joy that I welcome you here to St. Catharines, to Kentucky, and to the St. Catherine Award ceremony that we celebrate each year now. Before we begin our real celebration, I would like to introduce the members of the committee who prepared this. And Sister Joy Groh, wherever you are, she is our stand up. And she is our liaison with the leadership team. We have Sister Marianne Butka. She works over in the infirmary as financial officer over there. We have Sister Grace Sims, who is the chair of our committee. She also works at the college here. And we have one more. Let me see, where are you? Teresa Wolf. Where are you hiding? Here she is. And I am the other member of the committee. We welcome you too. And we feel that we like to have you on this property because it is the home of our mother house that we call St. Catherine's, St. Catherine of Siena Mother House. And it is on property that we have had some of our sisters living on for 178 years. So we welcome you to our home, to our property. And we welcome many, many people from out of state to this land of Kentucky. And there are a lot of Nebraskans here. And Joy came from Chicago, and there might be some from Staten Island. So I'd like to have the ones that are visiting from out of state stand so we can see who you are and welcome you. Thank you for coming and being a part of us and part of our endeavors. And we, of course, congratulate Catherine O'Callaghan having been here on our going to be Mother McCree right now, and it's going to be by her son Thomas O'Callaghan and his buddy Jim Brady. So thank you.
Love. Thank you very much. That was lovely. We are gathered here today to celebrate a story. And like all stories, it began once upon a time, long, long ago. Our story for today begins with the life of Catherine Benincasa in Siena, Italy. It is an extremely colorful story of a large family with many interesting characters. It is a story of a woman who was committed to the poor and suffering, who was a political activist, a traveler, a champion of women's rights before the concept ever emerged, a mystic, a scholar, a complex personality who created an extended family which she named the Bella Brigata, the Beautiful Brigade. The artwork in this hall, if you look up on the two sides, we have a mural on either side, really clearly depicts the many facets of our patroness, Catherine of Siena. On this side, we see the mystical marriage of Catherine and Jesus, which forms the basis of her mystical spirituality. So on this side, we have her spiritual life and the depths to which she was called. On the other side, and though some of you can see it, some of you can't, but we have Catherine confronting the Pope, telling him to return to Rome to be the leader he was called to be. Both sides of Catherine, the mystic and the activist. We know that she was a laywoman who was called Mama by some of her friends and followers. And her biographers tell us that she had no formal schooling, but that she was a tireless conversationalist. Sound familiar? She was a true Dominican, both a contemplative and a woman of action. And in her dialogue, St. Catherine of Siena writes, "If you act so, you will be my delight. Offer me not only words, but many works. For as I have told you, I want few words, but many works. I say many rather than giving you any number, because when the soul is grounded in charity, which gives life to all virtues, her desire must reach to the infinite. And as for words, I said I want few." Of course, we know that Catherine of Siena loved as many words as well as many works. And today, here at St. Catherine Mother House, we are celebrating those acts and those words as they live on in the life story of another Catherine, Catherine Mac O'Callaghan, the recipient of our Catherine of Siena Award. Now, this story, too, begins once upon a time. It is an extremely colorful story of a large family with many interesting characters, many of whom are seated right before us. It is a story of a woman who was committed to the poor and suffering, who is a political activist, a traveler, a champion of women's rights, a woman of faith, couldn't make her mystic yet, a scholar, a mother of a large family who has also created an extended family, which we may also call a Bella Brigata. We have Mama Caterina in Italy in the 14th century and Mama Mac in Staten Island in the 21st century. There is a connection between these two stories. Catherine McCarthy O'Callaghan's story begins in Greeley, Nebraska, where there was another mama who was raising another Bella Brigata. Agnes McCarthy, after the death of her husband in 1936, was a single parent raising the 8 McCarthy children, some of whom are here today. Well, all those McCarthy children raised their hands, so we know exactly who we're talking about. Well, we have sickness, and all the financial and emotional demands of raising 8 children alone. Hers was a life anchored in faith, family, and care for others. I can't help but think that this Bella Bogata was the nurturing place and the foundation for the life of our Cacking of Siena recipient, Catherine O'Callaghan. Catherine met her husband, Pierce O'Callaghan, at a dance in Grand Island, Nebraska. He was in the Army Air Force stationed in Nebraska. They married in 1944 and settled in Staten Island, New York. They are the parents of 10 children, 32 grandchildren, and 4 great-grandchildren. Catherine, you have earned the right to be called Mama. But in addition to raising 10 children, Catherine devoted herself to the works that Catherine of Siena writes about in her dialogue, works that flow from a deep sense of charity. Catherine regularly cooks for the homeless and persons who are suffering with AIDS. She has created her own Bella Bogata by welcoming many people into her home. Foreign exchange students, orphans, children in need of protection in a home. In 1995, she was given the William A. Morris Award of the Staten Island branch of the NAACP. The award was given to Catherine for her work in feeding and caring for the homeless and for her very significant work in the 60s in the founding of Daytop Village, a drug treatment center. In 1987, she was inducted into the Staten Island Hall of Fame. She has been involved in university women's groups and writes a monthly newsletter for the American Association of University Women. And I might just add as an aside, Catherine sent her children off to school and she didn't want to be outdone by them. So in the 1980s, she went back to school and received her bachelor's degree. Catherine has always been involved in the church and in her parish life, and like Catherine of Siena, has had the wisdom and the courage to confront church leaders. I'm sure there's a subtext there, but we won't go there today. You have been honored by many esteemed groups, Catherine, but today it is our turn to honor you. You are a part of our family. You have gifted us with the example of your life and your dedication and your holy preaching. And it is time for us to say thank you, to honor you, and to ask that you always continue to be a part of the Dominicans of St. Catherine, Kentucky. And on our part, we would always like to be a part of your beautiful Bella Bogata. Today, we present you the Catherine of Siena Award because you model for us what it means to be a holy preacher, what it means to follow in the footsteps of Catherine of Siena. Let me just get your award and I can present it to you.
Thank you. Catherine of Siena, when I got Mary Ann, Sister Mary Ann Butkus' letter telling me I won this award, I was thrilled, I was delighted, but then I thought, why me, why? I thought maybe just because my name is Catherine. My grandmother, I guess, started all of it. She named my mother Agnes Catherine. My mother named me Catherine Agnes. I named my daughter Catherine. My mother always told me I was named for St. Catherine of Siena. She read me a little book about Catherine of Siena when I was about 7 years old, but I long ago forgot what it was all about, but I didn't know that. So I thought, I must find out what she's all about. I thought, I'll go to the public library and get a book, and then I thought, maybe they would have a book of saints at the public library. I will go to the school library on Monday, ask Father's permission to look it up there. But then my daughter Suzanne said, why not go to the computer? I thought, well, who's going to find Sister Catherine on the computer? And I'm almost computer illiterate. So I said, Suzanne, would you look it up for me and see? She turned on AOL, typed in St. Catherine of Siena, and lo and behold, pages came out about her. How was I like? Well, the first sentence that came out of the computer was, St. Catherine of Siena was a virgin. Well, a virgin I am not. I had 10 children, 36 grandchildren. So there I'm opposite. Catherine of Siena died at age 35. I'm twice that. Catherine of Siena hobnobbed with the Pope. She told him what to do. Pope Gregory XI, I think, and Pope Urban VI or something. And I don't even know a pope. I ever got was 2 years ago, my little granddaughter went to Rome and brought me home a pair of little bare rosaries blessed by Pope John Paul, which I carry with me all the time. And this October, I'm going to Rome, so maybe I'll get a glimpse of it. And I'm taking a Dominican with me when I go. But there was something similar when I was thinking about it. She was interested in the poor and the downtrodden and the homeless. And that's the way I'm trying to work myself into heaven. I'm hoping the homeless will get me there. My two favorite songs that I try to live by is Whatsoever You Do and God of All the Hungry Millions. When I was little, I didn't think much about the homeless. Well, for the last 15 years, I've been thinking about the homeless. When I was small, I was doing my catechism. I was learning my lessons in the little country school yard in the plains of Nebraska. And then I went on to Sacred Heart School in Greeley, Nebraska, where I was first introduced to the Dominican Sisters. There I got my 4 years of good Catholic education with the Dominican Sisters. And they taught me much. Sister Agnes Fields was, she was a beautiful woman, very young, a beautiful woman. She was the choir director. I joined the choir, and I am singing away one day, and she's saying, there's someone a little off key, let's go. So we started again, and I'm singing away. So at the end of the lesson, she came over to me, and she said, Catherine, you can stay in the choir, just mouth it. That I also learned from Sister out there. There are nice ways of saying, telling somebody off. She could have said, you can't sing, get out of here, but she didn't. She was very sweet about it. And Sister Gabriel was another one that got much compassion. When my father died in 1937, I was out of school for 3 weeks. Now, why I was out of school for 3 weeks, I don't know, but I never shed a tear on my father's death after that point. I came into school, I'm sitting in the back desk, back I see, and Sister Gabriel comes over, puts her arms around me, says nothing, puts her arms around me, and I burst into tears. So that was the beginning of my healing process of my father's death. And other sisters, Sister Felix, Sister Mary Martin, Sister Mary Morris, were all my teachers that I still remember fondly. There are two sisters here today, I think Sister Carolyn and Sister Mary Lawrence, who were teachers. They weren't teachers. They didn't teach me, but they were in the Sacred Heart at that time. But I did learn much from the Dominican sisters. In fact, I learned so much that they awarded me a scholarship to the Hastings Business College on graduation. I went on, and the next year I became a secretary in the bank in Grand Island, Nebraska, and that's where I met my fly boy, married him, and moved to Staten Island, New York. So for the first few years in Staten Island, I was busy raising a family. And then when my kids started into the Immaculate Conception School, I started my volunteering there. I had 10 kids who went through that school. My father and my husband before them had gone through there. So we had 98 years of education in that school. So I rather felt that I owed them a little volunteering. And then the homeless. school. He was in St. Peter's High School. He was just finishing his senior year. And he said, we're not going to have an organized religion class the last semester. We just have to go out and get a community project to do. I said, well, I read in the church bulletin that Project Hospitality, the local homeless shelters, had a meeting looking for volunteers this afternoon. Let's go. So he and Don, a friend, a retired friend of ours, and I went down to see what they had to say. Well, they said they were opening this new shelter on Tuesday night. They needed volunteers to stay overnight with the men, and they needed people to cook. So John, Don and Mark signed up to stay overnight on Tuesday night. Don would sleep from 10 to 2. Mark would sleep from 2 to 7. They'd wake the men up, give them cereal, send them on the way. So I thought, well, since they're going to do that, why don't I volunteer to cook there on Tuesday night? So I did. And I cooked the first meal that was cooked in that shelter when it opened. June came, Mark graduated from high school. August came, he went on to Nebraska, the University of Nebraska. So that was the end of his volunteering there. But I was hooked. I stayed on. Everybody said, how wonderful. What a wonderful thing you're doing. But to me, I was getting much more out of it than I was giving. It was so nice just to make sure that knowing that these men had a good meal and were settled for the night. And of course they knew how to play on them. Every night that when I come in, oh, here comes our Tuesday night cook. This is our great cook, isn't this great? But I'm sure they said that to every cook every night. But I really was hooked on them. Then back in the 70s, my husband, I'm going back to the age now, this was after that, but back in the 70s, my husband was involved in the beginning of Daytop. Monsignor O'Brien had to want to start a Daytop on Staten Island, and it was much opposed by most people, so he worked with Monsignor O'Brien very close on that. I worked with them, but I was a solid follower. I hadn't learned how to be a leader at that time, but I he did great work in that. Let me see. After this shelter that I cooked for quite a few years closed, they closed. They moved the men so they could renovate this and make a home for 23 mentally and physically disabled people. So they closed the shelter, and then they went had to go from one church hall to another, and they ate down at the outreach center. So I still cooked on Tuesday night, but I didn't. They came and got the food and cooked it. So I missed the interaction with the men. I used to see them every Tuesday night. Now I saw them no more except on the Tuesday before the 4th of July. I always had them to my deck for a cookout. And the Tuesday before Christmas, I always had them to my house for a sit-down dinner. But now their number has grown so large that I can't fit them in my house for a sit-down dinner, so I have them at the school hall. That worked out very well, so hopefully we'll do that for years to come. But some people are just reluctant to get involved with the homeless, but you never know when you just that going that extra mile will mean so much to them. One of the 4th of July's, may have been the second or third one that I was having, and my daughter Marjorie gave me a blue kitchen fork set, a cutlery set. And I said, well, I'm not going to put that in. I don't have to buy plastic forks. I'll put these up. Usually on my deck, I have plastic forks, whether it's for my friends, my neighbors, even the mayor. But I said, no, I'll use these forks. So at the end of the day, this one man said, you know, the weather was beautiful, the food was good, the conversation was great. But the one thing I appreciated more than anything was a real fork. I haven't had a real fork in my hand. 5 years. So needless to say, glad that they've never had plastic again when they come to my deck. And another one that was hard to believe was this house where they had the home of the disabled. I made Easter baskets for them at Easter time. Last year I made Easter baskets for them and I got a card a couple weeks after. A beautiful handmade card with everybody's little thank you. This one man said, thank you for my Easter basket. Was the first gift that I ever received in my whole life. Well, naturally, I found out his birthday was in July. He got his second gift. But so you just never know. And this year, when I was making the Easter baskets, other people came forth. Some women donated candy for us that they could help me put them together. And so people do like to get involved, but sometimes they just don't know where to start. So invite people to join you, because that's how volunteerism grows, and you'll be thanked for it. They were so happy to be able to do this, and they're looking forward to doing it again next year. I have received a few awards in my lifetime, but the biggest one I received was 4 years ago when Terry Troyer, Reverend Terry Troyer, the minister who heads up Project Hospitality, got Cardinal O'Connor's permission to name this house on Tartar Street where I cooked the first dinner and went home with the disabled now in the Pearson Mac O'Callaghan House. So it's an award that we just never thought would ever happen. I'm just thrilled about it. But I have to tell you the story in closing. In closing, I have to tell you about my good friend, Sister, used to be Pauline Fitzpatrick. She's now Sister Agnes. She is the sister of Sister Maria Fitzpatrick. Well, a few years ago, I was down here talking to Sister Maria Fitzpatrick, and I was telling her how I graduated from the College of Staten Island at the ripe old age of 62, and how for my last 8 credits, I had written my memoirs from the prairie to the harbor. The first semester was Life on the Prairie. The second was Life on the Harbor. So Sister Maria asked to read my book. So I sent it to her. I was flattered she wouldn't read it. I sent it to her. She sent it on to Sister Agnes. But that's as far as I thought it would go. Well, that's not how far it came here today. So you people at this moment are totally bored. Blame it all on Sister Maria Fitzpatrick.
When I shine. to thank our musicians who drove all the way from New York yesterday to be here for this special event. And they have promised to continue playing during our reception, which will follow immediately. Let us pray now. Creator God, we thank you for this wonderful season of Easter, when you ask us to become Easter people, to live as your Son taught us to live, as our two Catherines that we've heard from today also live their lives. We just ask that you fill us with your life, with your new life, as the morning's dawn fills the morning sky. Help us always to be concerned, be compassionate, be understanding in everything that we do. We pray for safe travel for the McCarthy and O'Callaghan families as they leave here today. We pray for all the poor, the suffering, the hungry in Africa, those who are oppressed throughout the world, and we ask that we remember that we are your hands and feet in this world, and there are many things that we can do and should do. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.